can we give a warm welcome, round of applause to Mr. John Wardley.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I was originally not going to give a presentation because most of you have heard the kind of rubbish I talk normally, and I thought instead we'd just do a question and answer thing, and I'll just say, right, what do you want to know? But last week I just happened to be clearing out my attic, and I discovered this, and it basically is the original file that goes way back before we built Megaphobia. And I thought that I'd share with you the story about how Megaphobia came about. Basically, the McNamara family who first owned... Can you all hear, by the way? Or would you rather I use the microphone? Mm.
I said they couldn't hear at the barbecue, but when they were doing that, but...
The McNamara family who started Oakwood, and I was involved right from the beginning, as anyone that's read my book will know. The main ride here at Oakwood in those days was the bobsleigh ride, which is still here. There were no big thrill rides. And Oakwood was obviously a big success. It was doing extremely well. And after a couple of years, they asked me what was the next major attraction that they should build here. Now, the thing that had made Oakwood a success was the fact that a lot of it was built by the family, by local tradespeople. And they had a great talent for pulling together local trades and using local labour, and I felt that a Woody would be the perfect ride because a huge amount of the cost could actually be done by local labour. So I said to William and Paddy, I think you should build a Woody. Apart from Blackpool, Woodies in Britain were more or less unknown, unheard of, and I had every confidence that a wooden coaster would be a big success here. And William said to me, well, what's a Woody? And I described it to him, and he said, but they're old-fashioned and they're dangerous and nobody will want to ride one. So I thought the best way to convince him was to put him on a plane and take him over to the States. So Jenny, my wife, who sat over there, and myself put William McNamara on a plane, and we took him first to Kennywood, then to Cedar Point via various other parks in that part of the world. And he immediately realised that there was a fabulous attraction potentially at Oakwood, that if we used one of the main American designers, and that the hardware, the brakes, the trains, the lift, and so on, was supplied by the Americans, but local labour was used to fabricate the ride. The ride could then be built for a fraction of what a major ride would cost if you bought a steel coaster from one of the main coaster manufacturers. Now, I haven't actually looked through this file for a long time, but here is a memo from me dated the 12th of October 1993. Subject wooden coaster, and it says enclosed is a first basher to layout and profile of a wood coaster for Oakwood. It's a little higher and longer than your original brief, 27 meters high and 870 meters long, and is a fairly intense ride. So this is the memo that started it all. This really got it going, and I then produced a profile and a layout. Now, this is the original profile that I did of Megaphobia, and a layout plan. Of course, in those days there were no such thing as CAD design, so it was all done on tracing paper with done the hard way in pencil. We then plotted it out on site, and eventually Custom Coasters were involved to slightly reshape it, do quite a lot of reprofiling, but the ride that you see out there now is very, very similar indeed to the original layout. Now, this is a very interesting piece of paper for the European Coaster Club, because it is addressed to First Drop, Coaster House 16 Charles Street, Hillingdon, Middlesex, and it's from William and Paddy McNamara. And it reads, "Dear," and it's dated the 31st of January 1995. And it reads, "Dear all, as you are well aware, Oakwood Park has received planning permission to build a wooden roller coaster at the park. We are delighted to announce exclusively to yourselves that yesterday, Monday the 30th of January 1995, we signed a contract with Custom Coasters Inc. to build the ride. It is anticipated that site works will commence in May and the ride will be fully operational in plenty of time for an Easter opening in 1996. The coaster will be 82 feet high, have a track length of some 2,900 feet. Two PTC trains will operate on the track. CCI's president, Mrs. Denise Larrick, says Oakwood's new Woody will probably be CCI's wildest design yet. It will be 25 metres tall, have 11 crossovers, the most CCI have ever done, be full of banks, speed and airtime. She goes on to say the Oakwood coaster will be built for thrills. We're pushing the thrill envelope farther than just about anything we've ever done. It will be vaguely similar to the Predator at Darien Lake, but this will be more dramatic and full of turns. As soon as the track profile is finalised, we would be delighted for you to view the plans and visit the site. We will keep you well informed and look forward to a good working relationship with yourselves." That yourselves being you, the members of the European Coaster Club. So as you will see, it is you, the members of the European Coaster Club, that were in on Megaphobia right from the beginning, and you had this exclusive announcement about this ride. So I think it's wonderful that 18 years later, we're all here now, and we can still be proud of that ride. So I thought I'd just share this with you, because it is quite significant. You now have a rough insight into how Megaphobia came about, and I think it's a ride that we are all of us still very proud of, and I think it still is the signature ride at Oakwood. Some may disagree with me, but I think it probably still is the signature ride at Oakwood. So that's the presentation bit. So now it's just a case of saying, what do you want to know? Not just about Oakwood, but about the rides that I've been involved in, the industry, and me in general. So it's over to you.
Oh, come on, don't be shy.
Well, obviously everybody knows it all. And
I worked at Thorpe Park previously, and Merlin are very much kind of about steel coasters, and I know Nick Varney's said quite publicly that a wooden coaster isn't marketable at all now, whereas you've obviously yourself said that you think Megaphobia was the best thing for Oakwood at the time. So do you think going forward that we'll be able to get a good steel coaster, a good wooden coaster added at a UK park, or do you think it could only be at a small park, you know, that's not part of the Merlin Group?
That's a very, very good question. It all depends on the marketing people at the parks being able to prove to Nick Varney and the Merlin board that they are going to be able to market the Woody. I have seen with my own eyes the way research bombs badly. I've seen it myself. If you go, most of the big entertainment companies spend a lot of money doing blind research, where groups of people are taken into a room, they don't know what they're being asked to comment on. As soon as one starts to show pictures of Woodies, as soon as you start to ask people their opinions, it doesn't go well. I've seen it myself. as soon as you put somebody on a ride, everything changes. And this was why when I first talked to William McNamara about a Woody, his reaction was exactly the same as everyone else's. They're dangerous, they're old-fashioned, nobody wants to ride them. I took him to America because I knew that was the only way to really get him to experience, other than Blackpool, a Woody for himself. And we came back and he was absolutely convinced it was the right ride. I am still, although in theory I'm retired, I'm still not giving up. The Stampeder at Port Aventura was an interesting ride for me. It was the ride that I built after this one. By combining the twin track racer with the kiddie track, it really did prove that you could create a fun family attraction that had broad appeal. And it's been a very successful ride there. But every time I've tried to persuade Merlin to build a Woody in one of their British parks, I get exactly the same reaction. But I firmly believe that Alton Towers now has an incredibly talented marketing director in Justin Platt. He has a totally open mind about these things, and I want to put him on some Woodies, take him over the steps, put him on some Woodies, so that he himself can experience it. I've no doubt whatsoever that Candy Holland and the team in the Acton Studios could do a fantastic job. We designed 4 years ago a Wallace and Gromit Woody for Alton Towers. We then designed a sort of spooky horror circus themed Woody, which would have been amazing, and Candy did an incredible job on designing the theming of that. There are all sorts of ways in which theming can be added to a Woody. The terrain at Alton Towers is superb for something like that. So, the answer is, it all depends on the marketing people being able to prove to the board that they can make it work. So, you know, we just all must keep our fingers crossed. Unfortunately, you guys realise that there's no point in lobbying me. When I used to come to Coaster Club events, virtually every other person that came up to me said, "When are you going to build a Woody?" And it frankly got a bit tedious, because it was as if I wasn't trying, and I really was trying. I was doing my utmost to get a Woody built. I still know that it would be a fabulous ride. I think it would not be as easy to market as a ride that has got a very straightforward, unique selling point. But the clever thing that Justin Platt has been able to do with the Smiler at Alton Towers is that he didn't even need to use that unique selling point of the world's first 14 inversion coaster in his marketing until the very end of the campaign. So in a way, he sort of played into our hands, because the directors were sort of saying, you need that unique selling point, and he never even needed to use it. So I have every confidence that he has the ability, if anybody has, to be able to convince the Merlin board that a Woody would be an appropriate ride and would be a popular ride. It might not be easy to get the quick hit with it. I mean, this is the thing. It's dead easy to build the world's highest, the world's fastest, you know, these kind of superlatives. But as you all know, they're not necessarily the world's best. And if you set out to design the world's best, it doesn't necessarily have that unique selling point. So it's a marketing issue, as simple as that. And I just hope that one day it'll happen. So, it's a good question. Anyone else?
Yeah. With the Smiler at Alton Towers, were there any other manufacturers talked about than Gerslauer, and what sort of manufacturers were they, and why was Gerslauer chosen for the ride?
Right, the Smiler, again, it was all down to this unique selling point. that Nick Varney always insists that there should be two criteria that should be met in order for a project to even hit the drawing board. And one is, what is the compelling proposition? And the other is what he calls the killer image. The compelling proposition is a phrase, not even a sentence, but a phrase that sums up what the ride is. So in the case of the Smiler, it was going to be the world's first 14 inverting roller coaster. And the killer image is a single photograph, which when you show it to somebody, they say, wow, that is fantastic. If you cannot give him those two things, he doesn't want to know. He doesn't want you to sit down and explain in a paragraph, let alone a sentence, but a paragraph, what the attraction is, because he says you have got to be able to convey that to the public in a few words. And also, you've got to be able to hold up a photograph and immediately everybody say, that is amazing, we want to go there, we want to ride it. So, with the Smiler, I mean, we went up so many blind alleys with that thing. And my favourite was going to be, although I'm not a great lover of stand-up coasters by any means, my favourite was a ride that we designed to go around Katanga Canyon, which would have had a huge drop to it down into a hole. We were going to excavate a hole, a very, very deep hole, and drop a stand-up coaster down a hole. And it would have been a very expensive ride. It was going to be a B&M ride. Various people thought we will never get planning permission for it, because as you know, planning, well, you know as well as anybody, don't you, that planning consent at Alton Towers is a problem. So much time was wasted by people at Merlin's head office wanting us to come up with the world's first. They said, what about putting people in a sort of ball that rolls along the track? Or what about a coaster that is sort of part above and part below the track? Or a coaster that has got a train that has got some stand-up, some regular seats, some inverter seats, some stand-up seats, so you can choose which seats. And all this was going to cost a lot of money to do and gobble up a large proportion of the budget, all for the sake of gimmicks. And we went up so many blind alleys, and time was tight. And so in the end, it was decided that the only place that we would be able to put a big new roller coaster at Alton Towers that was going to be able to get planning consent was on the old black hole site. Now that black hole tent was a big tent, but in roller coaster terms, it wasn't, the site itself wasn't that big. Everyone was very pleased with Saw at Thorpe Park. The degree to which it was due to the Saw intellectual property was debatable, but the ride had reasonable capacity. You could pack in a reasonable amount of track in a small space. And so Mark Fisher said to me, is there any way in which we could use a Gerstlau Eurofighter and get some world's first record to it? We obviously couldn't have the highest. We certainly couldn't have the steepest, because now, you know, they were sort of going beyond vertical. And I said, well, I suppose we could just pack in the greatest number of inversions. Not that that is necessarily going to make for an excellent ride, but if you really do want a world record breaker that will sort of get in the record books, maybe that's the way to do it. So he said, well, who holds the record? So I said, well, we do it at Thorpe with Colossus. So he said, right, well, shall we build an 11 inverter? And I said, well, I think if you're going to try and beat the record, it's a bit dodgy beating it by one or two, because you can bet your boots that somewhere around the world is trying to beat Colossus and is doing an 11 or 12. Don't want to build 13 for bad luck, and you've got a ride called that in any case. So let's go for 14. But you only need look at a ride here like Speed, and you can see that in order to get a reasonable length of track and a reasonable number of inversions, the amount of energy that you need to put in the train is quite high. and we couldn't even go up as high as speed, really. So it was necessary to have a two-lift ride. So the idea that one of the lifts would be vertical, one of them would be a regular incline lift, and then we would pack as many inversions in as possible. Now, this was a huge, huge problem, because it meant that if you didn't get the exit from any given inversion absolutely perfect, there was no room whatsoever to correct it in the transition before you entered the next inversion. It had to be absolutely perfect. Normally, after you've gone through one inverted configuration, you allow yourself a few meters of track just to correct yourself before you enter the next. And here there was going to be no space for that. So the ride layout was incredibly complicated. I did the original ride layout. I think Werner Stengel then reworked it a bit. We then discovered that we had to stretch the ride, because we had the set of toilets at the top of the site, and I had tried to keep the ride down to the south of the toilets, but in the end we realised we couldn't, so that's why it had to go over the top of that toilet block. But it was a very, very complicated exercise to build the Smiler. It for those of you that haven't ridden it, it is a good ride. If your idea of a good ride is just being turned upside down as many times as possible in the shortest space of track as possible. When people ask me which is better, the Smiler or Nemesis, for my money, at least Nemesis takes you on an adventure. It you go somewhere, you feel as if you're achieving something, whereas the Smiler is basically just a very intense experience. I was the first, well, the story of exactly how we got, I'll tell you now exactly what happened on that first run. As you will all know, it was incredibly behind schedule. The technical problems that they faced with that ride were enormous, and they found when they started excavating the site there were geological problems. There was floods, there was snow, and it was a very, very tricky project indeed. And consequently, it was very, very behind schedule. But in the end, the marketing people at Alton Towers agreed that the ITV breakfast news programme could have their weather forecast, their weather forecasting girl, do the first run live on television. Now, whenever we've done these first runs in the past, it's all a bit of a cheat, because dozens of people have really ridden them. I can remember with Nemesis, I think we managed to sort of sell the first run to about five different exclusives, and I don't think anybody ever realised that they'd been conned. Blue Peter had the first run, I think Tomorrow's World had the first run, the local ITV News had the first run, I think a journalist from The Sun had the first run. So, you know, but on this particular occasion, it was really quite bizarre, because we had promised that they could have the first run live, and we assumed that we would be able to run the ride, and we'd be riding it for several days, if not weeks, beforehand. But at 2 o'clock in the morning, before the broadcast was going out, no human being had ever actually ridden the ride. It had gone round with sandbags, but nobody had ridden it. The weather girl was due to do her first weather report at, I think, about 6:30 in the morning. By 5 o'clock that morning, no human being had even ridden it. At 5:15, the commissioning engineer from Gerstlauer and our inspecting engineer got on board, and we did the first run with them. And then suddenly we looked at the time and we realised that the weather girl was about to do her report. So we bunged her on the train, and apart from the two inspecting engineers, she really was the first person to ride it. I was then due to do an interview with her half an hour later, talking about the ride, and so Keith Workman, who was the project manager, said to me, well, we better ride it, hadn't we? And I said, well, I think it's wrong that I should. There are lots more people in the queue before me, as far as people that have worked through the snow and the icy winds, and they deserve to ride it before me. And Keith said, well, no, if you've got to talk to the television cameras in a few minutes about what it's like, you better ride it. So the two of us got on, and we were the next people to ride it. So it really was quite last minute, and then it sort of went on from there. So that's how the Smiler came about. The thing that has come out of the Smiler that really does please me is that although it was conceived around that unique selling point, Justin Platt, who I think is the best thing to arrive at Alton Towers for a long time, didn't even need to use that. And that bodes very, very well for the future, because he can now say to the Merlin board, you know, I believe that this is, or whatever is the right ride, and I know I can market it. I don't need it to be the highest, the fastest, the longest, or whatever. So I think the Smiler might be a turning point. Nobody wants me to dish the dirt on anything at all, right? Okay.
John, I have a question for you. I come from mainland Europe. Are you involved in the Hyde Park wind coaster also?
Yeah, I did the layout and profile for the Hyde Park wind coaster. I have a very good relationship with Walter Bolliger, and I did the first layout, and I don't think it's been modified. The layout has been modified very significantly from the layout that I worked up for them. Yeah.
You know whose idea it was to use the space of the log flume over deck for the vehicle?
Well, Hyde Park has got two of everything, as you well know, and it was, we thought it pretty stupid having two log flumes, and the oldest and probably the least satisfactory was that particular log flume. So it was decided also that in order to make the best use of the wind coaster's features, an interesting terrain with interesting topography was best. And that part of the site has got the most interesting topography. If we put it on the other log flume site, that's more or less a flat site. So that's why that particular site was chosen. Well, it all really tends to stem from the marketing people. The marketing people say, you know, this is what we have a need for. They might not talk in specifics, but in generic terms, they will say, in the case of Saw, for example, they said we want a very intense teenage thrill ride. In the case of 13, it was to be a ride that had edge but would be a family ride. Young families could ride and still enjoy it, but work with the teenagers. And I think that's worked extremely well, actually, with 13. The number of people that go on 13 and come off and say that was great fun, once you've ridden it, you then want to encourage other people to ride it and not let in on the secret of what happens. So it tends to start with the marketing people, who will say, we want a ride that will appeal to a particular sector of the market. And then maybe people will say, well, there is an area of the site that we feel is suitable for a new attraction. So it could be that, or it could be the engineers saying, you know, we feel that we would like a such and such a ride to maintain, rather than, you know. There are lots of other things. In fact, I was talking to Dominic recently about rides. Things like Rapids rides consume huge amounts of electricity, so there's no point. And of course, the other so do launch coasters. We've looked at lots of launch coasters for our parks, and before the new power storage systems that are now available, which are very expensive, One of the things that prohibits a lot of parks from building big launch coasters is that they can't afford to bring in a new power supply. For those of you that remember the Thunder Looper, the power was stored by means of a dirty great big weight that was winched up a tower and dropped off down into the ground, and that fired the train forward. But doing it in a slightly more sophisticated way nowadays, you either need to have a big power supply available at the park or an expensive power storage system which is able to store the electrical power between launches. So there are technical things that you take into consideration, there are marketing things that you take into consideration, there are site restrictions, and Alton is the classic example where the planners basically will hardly let us build anything there. And also, we do listen to the guests. You know, a huge amount of feedback comes from guests. And to a certain extent, we look around the world and we see what other people are building and not necessarily copy it. I think we've probably originated quite a few rides, actually. And I know that the day after 13 opened, virtually the entire industry around the world all turned up to ride it to see just what it was all about. So there are lots of different criteria that are used, but it tends to start off with marketing.
Regarding the Woody Alton Towers that never was, I know it got to the planning stage and failed up. What was the actual reason it failed on the planning? The rumours of newts in the woods and that sort of thing. Is that the truth or was it something else?
Well, which Woody? I mean, we've designed so many of the things. We've designed Woodies that have been behind the towers. We've designed Woodies that are behind where the old 1001 Nights was, which was where John Broome was going to build the big BHS coaster. We've got Cross Valley Woodies. There have been a huge number of Woodies.
The
Cross Valley, that again fell really because of the unique selling point. Because I know it would have been a fantastic ride. But Nick Varney basically said, yes, but what is the unique, is it going to be the highest? I said, no, it's not. Is it going to be the fastest? No, it's not. What is it going to be? And I just said, well, it's going to be a fabulous roller coaster that everyone's going to want to ride. But that was not good enough. Now, I don't know. I don't think that the Cross Valley coaster is dead in the water at all. The planners were coming around to our way of thinking. The locals were, you know, there's some that are very pro Alton Towers and some that are very anti Alton Towers. You know, there are ways of sort of dealing with this, but certainly it was nothing to do with newts.
It was one of the rumours that was floating around.
Yes.
I think the Towers might be open to look at the new hybrid track systems, such as the Rocky Mountain construction system.
Yeah, it's a good question. The hybrid systems, I would like to see at least another year of use before I would commit to it, because when it comes to metal fatigue on that fabricated strip, that topper track or the rolled beam, I'd be interested to see what happens in a year's time as to metal fatigue, whether cracks start appearing. I'm no metallurgist, but I wouldn't be happy right now going for that. But I think it certainly is the way forward. The likes of Terry Dunn at Alton Towers would probably breathe a big sigh of relief if something like that came along, rather than the conventional laminated track, which unless you're, you know, very, very diligent as Dom and his team are, requires a huge amount of inspection and maintenance to keep it running well. I haven't ridden Megaphobia today, but certainly, you know, it's a credit to you guys the way you keep that ride, you know, in tip-top condition. And you know, as you all know, a Woody is more art than science, and it requires tender loving care. It requires people who love that ride to maintain it. You can't just produce a maintenance manual for a Woody and give that to a maintenance guy and say, there you are, maintain that. Now, this new hybrid track does take a little bit of the uncertainty out of maintaining a Woody. There's no doubt about it. I've yet to ride one. I'm sure most of you guys already have. You can tell me whether it really does feel like a Woody or whether it feels like a regular steel coaster. But it's something that I think Alton Towers would, and I'm saying Alton Towers all the time. There's no reason why, you know, the other parks in the group couldn't be considering a Woody. I mean, the number of times that first to Swords people and then Merlin people have been here to Oakwood to ride Megaphobia, and they all come off saying, fantastic ride, yes, we've got to have one, and then it all fizzles out. So maybe a combination of imaginative marketing and some technical improvements to wooden coaster technology might be the thing that clinches it. I don't know.
We were saying that and talking about other parks in the group. Foot Park, we had a behind the scenes thing there. We saw GCI's plans for what was the source site. So, I mean, did you have any sight on them, or did you have any input with anything with Foot?
Well, yeah, I mean, I was involved in SOAR, and the reason why the Woody wasn't chosen was for the reasons I've said. You know, it's all down to this marketing business.
It's a shame, because if anyone has seen the plans, it just looked phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. It's just like,
Well, a Woody would have been absolutely perfect. I was pushing for a twin-track racer. And as long as parks genuinely race them, I think there's nothing sadder than having a racing coaster that isn't being raced. But a twin track racer doesn't necessarily need to be a gigantic ride. And also, what wasn't actually commonly known was we were, with that particular plan, we were going to slip some linear induction motors onto the track so that we could actually fix the race. the idea was that nobody would know the outcome of the race other than the computer, and the computer would actually, before, it's rather like these modern fruit machines, you know, that in fact, as soon as you put your coin in, before the reel starts spinning, the machine knows exactly where it's going to stop. With that we were going to ensure that it really was a fun race, first one train, then the other, and we wouldn't get the situation that so often with wooden races that you begin to realise which train on a particular day in wet weather or dry weather or whatever was going to win the race. So we were going to cheat a little bit, and we were going to put some limbs on the track, and we're going to actually give the odd train a nudge here and there around so that it was a fun race, and you wouldn't know who was going to win right up to the very end, which is, let's face it, what a race is all about. But that would have been a fantastic ride for Thorpe. Wish we built it.
If you want to see a very small race or a good one, you have to go to the Efteling.
Yeah, I mean, the Efteling have proven that you don't need to build a gigantic ride. Now, what was that first Woody they built, that little?
I guess it was a figure eight old one.
Yeah, that was the one that had the polyurethane wheels,
yeah.
and that was not a very successful ride. It didn't really do Efteling any good at all. But you people don't need to convince me that Woodies and racing Woodies aren't great rides.
So what do you prefer then, John, steel or wood?
Well, it is horses for courses. I mean, if the only rides in the world were woodies, you know, we'd be saying, let's build some steel coasters. You know, it's a case of a mixture. A well-designed steel coaster is far better than a badly designed woody. So, I, but I love Woody's. If I had a choice, if I go to a park and I can either ride a steel coaster or I can ride a Woody, I would ride a Woody out of choice. Well, the trouble is, you see, Joe, they don't lean towards them.
That's the trouble.
I think that a Woody allows the park to express itself in their coaster, whereas, a steel coaster tends to be more formulaic. Whereas a Woody, it's a case of some carpenters and some nails and sculpting a coaster for the park. You know, that's more and more the case with steel coasters. You know, as you probably know, in the early days of Arrow Developments, that was prior to Aerodynamics, and then Vekoma, all their steel coasters were pretty formulaic. The original Arrow Corkscrew was a standard layout, and then all the early Vekoma rides that were built after they licensed from Arrow were standard layout coasters. But as the years have gone by, they've become more and more custom built. Yeah. Well, I better let you have your barbecue now if you've got no more questions.
Just another question, John. I've got quite a big interest with Port Aventura. I was just wondering, around the time of Stampeder, do you have much else to do with any of the other rides at the park?
The Stampeder was the last ride before Tussauds sold it.
Yeah.
And they sold Port Aventura and bought Thorpe Park with the money that they sold Port Aventura with.
With any of the original rides at the park, like Al Diablo and things like that, for example?
As I explained in the book, Peter Selinger from Tussauds and I were sent over to Port Aventura. We were the first people to go there from Tussauds. Basically, La Caixa, the Spanish bank, and Anheuser-Busch felt that they needed a third party in there to deal with the Spanish. And we were felt an appropriate company that bridged the cultural gap between America and Spain, but also knew the theme park market. So when Pearson were first approached by La Caixa to see if they were interested in investing in Port Aventura, Peter and I were sent over to look at it. And Peter from the business standpoint and me from the point of view of the layout of the park and the attractions. And when we got there, most of the rides had been designed and some of the ride contracts had been signed. El Diablo was one of the contracts that had been signed, and also the Flume ride from Mack, and they were both pretty weird layouts. Mm. I wasn't at all happy with El Diablo, and they were about to sign the contract with Vekoma for the big coaster. And this was going to be remarkably similar to the Loch Ness Monster at Busch Gardens, with interlocking loops. And it was being sold on the basis of the image of the two trains going through the loop as simultaneously. And I said, well, if this is going to be your main selling point, how often is this going to happen? And they said, well, every ride. And I said, well, of course it's not going to happen every ride. All you need is a delay in the dispatch or one train running faster than another, and this isn't going to happen. And in any case, this is virtually a clone of the same ride that you built 16 years ago. So I phoned back to London and said, would you please send instructions to La Caixa to say that they're not to sign any more ride contracts. So I think only, there were no contracts signed with Intamin, but there was the Flume contract with Mack, and there was the El Diablo from Arrow, and those were fait accomplis. We couldn't do anything about that. But we just built Nemesis at Oakwood Towers. We're very, very happy with B&M. And we thought, that B&M would be far better qualified to produce a very big, intense, thrilling, spectacular coaster than the plans that had been drawn up with Vekoma. So Dragon Khan, came out of it. So that's how Port Aventura came about. And then I thoroughly enjoyed being out there, and certainly the run up to opening a park. There's something very exciting about a brand new park that has never ever opened to the public, and you stand there on opening day and you see this great wall of thousands of people all pouring through the turnstiles for the very, very first time. And it was a very exciting experience for me. I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I think it's a lovely park. Mm. But for various reasons, Pearson decided that they wanted to sell their holding, and then as a consequence, we were able to get rid of the annoyance of the opposition just round the M25 from Chessington called Thorpe Park by owning it ourselves. You can't beat enjoyment. Mm-hmm. So that's how that came about. Anything else? Right, well, yeah.
With Stampede, when they put the new trains, do you think it may be ruined the ride a bit?
I haven't been to Port Aventura since they put those trains on, so I couldn't
it
say.
It seems like it's a lot rougher now.
No, I don't know, to be honest. Sorry.
I spoke with Brendan Stein a couple of years ago, and I know he does this ride often again that he designed to see what you have to do better on some certain rides. Do you do the same?
I think probably Werner Stengel is the person that we really should thank for most of the rides in the world. I mean, he's an unsung hero. He's a clever man, in as much as the secret of him is that very clever piece of software which was originally designed for German autobahns, to design the banking of slip roads around German motorway junctions. And that was then converted to produce the dynamic calculations for roller coasters. And he works for everybody. I don't think there is a roller coaster manufacturer in the world that doesn't use Werner Stengel. It's quite extraordinary. Everybody sends their designs through to him just to check them out. And when they come back with a tick in the box, you can breathe a sigh of relief and know that it will stay glued together and it'll be relatively smooth. Or it's then down to your tube vendors to muck it up. But he now, of course, he's retired, and he used to make a point of checking out all his rides, not just immediately after they opened, but subsequent years, which I've always done. I mean, I haven't ridden many of the rides at Alton Towers this year, but I will be shortly, and it's just nice to see how they mature. Maybe that's a euphemism, mature, I don't know, but it is, and I just love the things as well.
Anything else?
Ladies and gents, I think we need a great round of applause. You know, he's actually moving as well, so he's really done us a favour by stopping packing boxes for a while and coming down to visit us. So John, greatly appreciated, and we wish you all the best for your retirement and your move as well. Thank you.